Hey, let's talk about five ways that you could immediately improve your chances of protecting your security, your privacy, and your money while online. My name is Shad Sluder. I'm a professor at Grand Canyon University. I teach information security courses as well as programming and computer science. So let's get started on five ways that you may not have thought of to make yourself safer. First of all, let's talk about advice for improving your passwords. Now, we all know that passwords can be guessed. And if you look at this horrible table that was published by the Wall Street Journal, you'll see that people continually use bad passwords. You don't even need to be a computer scientist or hacker sometimes to get into your accounts. You just chose something that was easy to guess. However, even if you choose something that's not in a common password list, it might be vulnerable to cracking. Let's talk about what cracking means. So there are really several steps for cracking a password. First of all, out of your control, a company or school or hospital or anyone that has an account with you gets hacked, and that company loses all of its information. The hackers download the account information and they send it back to China or North Korea or whoever is looking at the accounts. Fortunately, the companies that have your password use a process called hashing. It's like encryption. And so a hashed password is unreadable for a human. Or is it? What they can do then is, with the advantage of time, they have the password in their possession and they just need to guess what it is. And so they set up a cracking machine. A cracking machine simply goes through a list of all combinations of passwords and asks, is this one going to match a password? So they ask, is AAA your password? No. How about AAB, AAC, and so on? And so millions of times per second, they can check to see if your password matches one of the known hashes. To see how hashes work, let's take a look at this webpage and see what an MD5 hash generator will do. Let's say I live in Phoenix and I think that Cardinals is a good password to pick. And it says here, the hashed value of Cardinals is this number here, this long string. So let's just do a quick Google search on it and see what comes up when we do a hash for Cardinals. We got a list here that says the top 10,000 most passwords used. And look at here. They show that there are normal passwords and their accompanying hash value. And so if I do a Control F and type in card, and sure enough, Cardinals is one of the most 10,000 used passwords in the list. And the password has already been hashed for me. I don't even need a hacking machine to be able to find this. So even if your password is hashed, and it was an easy one to guess, they'll be able to crack it within seconds. However, if you have a longer password, your odds of getting hacked are a lot less. Look at this chart to see how long it would take for a high-powered cracking machine to go through and do all the guesswork that it takes to guess your password. If you're using just 7 characters in your password, it's going to take less than a second for them to find out what it is. 8 characters goes to 5 hours, and you can see 5 days, 4 months, 10 years. And if you're good and you use 12 characters in your password, it will likely take them centuries for them to guess what your password is. They're going to just look at the thousands of the passwords that they have, and they're going to go for the easy ones first. So you just have to be a little bit better than the average, and your passwords will be less likely to be hacked. A longer password, though, doesn't necessarily mean it's difficult to remember. Take a look at these two passwords. They are both 20 characters long. Which one are you going to use? Well, the first one is incomprehensible. I'll never remember that. However, the second one is not too bad. Pizza is really good eating. It's a true statement. It's also a good one for a password because it's got 20 letters in it. Or how about this one? If you say, oh, I can think of just a single word, goal. Can I use that for a password? You certainly can. It's 20 characters. And it's just as hard for the computer to guess the first one as it is the second one because it has no idea how many letters go into the word goal. Well, there you go. So use a longer password even though it might not be a confusing password. Extra characters make a big difference. So if you were to put in just digits, 1 through 9, your password will be cracked instantaneously. However, if you change one of those characters to a letter, it will take about 50 years for all the combinations to be guessed. And so just changing to a capital letter or adding an exclamation mark or any kind of a character increases your odds greatly. Also, your password should not be naked. You should be using what's called two-factor authentication. You've probably used this before where you have to have a phone that gets a signal or gets a text message from your company. So it's a second login attempt. It's especially good to have if you're using a new device to log in. And so the hackers might have a laptop computer that's never been used before with your bank, and that will be asked for a second login using two-factor authentication. So it'll keep the bad guys out. Even if they have your password, they still can't get into your bank account and drain all the funds. So also, it's nice to know that your texting is no longer considered secure. Phones themselves are not secure. People can get programs to mimic your phone, and they don't even have to steal your device to be able to use it. They can clone your device and use texting without your knowledge. So banks and other services are phasing out texting in favor of more secure two-factor authentication. So Google has a process they call Google Sign-In, and it seems to be much better. Second, in your online quest for security, think about freezing your credit account. Not just think about it, do it. Do it now. Because your personal information has already been stolen, most likely. In 2017, a company that you may have never heard of was hacked, and they had tons of information about you. You're not their customer, you're their product. They're a credit agency. And so every time you go to apply for a loan, get a credit card, or buy a car, or whatever your process is, the companies are going to check your credit. And they check your credit through companies like Equifax. Well, Equifax lost 150 million accounts of Americans. Not just accounts like their credit card number, but they lost your Social Security number. They lost your phone number, your driver's license number, all this personal identification that never changes. So you might be able to cancel your credit card and get a new number, but you can't cancel your Social Security number. No matter what anyone says when they call you and says that it expired, they don't expire. And so your account was already taken. So what could you do? Well, you could wait till they attack you. You could have been a victim already, or they might just wait 10 years or so before they start using your information. It's literally a time bomb that's waiting to happen, and you will be the victim, and you'll be surprised. What can you do to protect yourself? Well, you can freeze your account. So this means that nobody can open up a new credit card in your name unless they actually unlock the account. And so the US government here and their official page has given advice to say you should probably freeze your account, which means every time you have to open up a new credit card or every time you have to buy a new car, you have to unfreeze your account temporarily. So it's a little bit of a hassle, but it certainly is a worthwhile investment of your time to protect what could be an identity theft. So here's number three. Stop using public Wi-Fi. It's free, I know. But free Wi-Fi access points can be faked. The fake ones look like the real ones. So you might see coffee shop and then another coffee shop. Or you might see free McDonald's Wi-Fi listed. Don't believe it. These people are using what's called a man-in-the-middle attack that can steal all of your keystrokes, all of the traffic that goes through your web browser, and then they can use those sessions to do whatever they want. Now think of how much it costs to use free Wi-Fi. It's free, but so is your phone. A lot of you already have unlimited data plans, so just keep using those. They work. And even if you have to pay for the data, it's a low price to pay for the security that comes with it. The fourth idea for making yourself more secure is to share less. Now I know it's nice to share, but personal information can be gathered and used against you in a digital stakeout. Let's say you post on your Instagram feed that you're gone for 2 weeks to Hawaii. Well, isn't that a nice invitation? Nobody home. Let's go break in. And so what was meant for your friends became a digital stakeout for criminals. Now think about if you were going to attack a business. You wanted to infiltrate them. You wanted to do a Mission Impossible. To make your job easy, all you have to do is a digital stakeout to think about how you can fake and break and steal about that company. So if you knew who the company's CEO was, you could fake letters that looked like theirs. If you knew what their addresses were in a network, you could probably break in easier. If you knew what phone system they had, you could probably hack it. If you found any weaknesses in it, you could look at the operating systems they use, the company's security service that they use, who are their big customers. There's a lot that you could gather online about a company, and you've never even set foot on the property. Well, the same goes with checking you out. People can do a digital stakeout against you, and if you share with them, they don't have to look very far. So imagine if you shared all of this information. You shared your pet name. You've shared where you work previously. You shared your mother's maiden name, your employer, your bank name, whether you're a company of a subscriber to a cable company, your car that you use. Anything that you share can be used in ways that you could use as friends, but it also could be used against you if you're trying to spoof or break into your accounts. So go look at your Facebook profile and just delete things that people really don't need to know. Because criminals, they don't even need to break in to find out who you are. You've already told them. Lastly, the last piece of advice is don't steal. Now I know thou shalt not steal will make us afraid because we think that we're going to get caught. However, movies and software that you get for free comes with a surprise. It's called a Trojan horse. And so you might download Photoshop and use it, but there's something else that they gave you along with it that you didn't expect. So the real risk is not being caught by the FBI. The real risk is that somebody else is looking at your computer, even as you're typing now. So there's your summary. Look at these five things that you may not have thought of, but using better passwords, freezing your credit, avoiding public Wi-Fi, sharing less, and not stealing are probably going to increase your chances of protecting your privacy, your money, and your online services. So I hope you put these into practice right away. My name is Shad Sluder. I am a teacher at Grand Canyon University. Check out the other hundreds of videos on my channel to teach you how to be a programmer with web development and mobile applications, as well as more standard applications that are used every day. So thanks for watching.